Many people are very confident they don't have sentience. But if you ask them, what do you mean by sentience? They say, I don't know, but they don't have it. That seems a rather inconsistent position, to be confident they don't have it without knowing what it is. So I prefer to focus on subjective experience. I think of that as like the thin end of the wedge. If you could show they have subjective experience, then people will be less confident about consciousness and sentience. So let's talk about subjective experience. When I say, suppose I get drunk, and I tell you, I have the subjective experience of little pink elephants floating in front of me. Most people interpret that, they have a model of what that means, and I think it's a completely incorrect model. And their model is, there's an inner theatre, and in this inner theatre, there's little pink elephants floating around, and only I can see them. That's the sort of standard model of what the mind is, at least as far as perception is concerned. And I think that model's completely wrong. It's as wrong as a religious fundamentalist model of the material world. Maybe the religious fundamentalist believes it was all made 6,000 years ago. That's just nonsense. It's wrong. It's not that it's a truth you can choose to believe. It's just wrong. So I think people's model of what the mind is just wrong. So let's take, again, I have the subjective experience of little pink elephants floating in front of me. And I'll now say exactly the same thing without using the word subjective experience. Okay, here goes. My perceptual system is telling me something I don't believe. That's why I use the word subjective. But if there were little pink elephants floating in front of me, my perceptual system would be telling me the truth. That's it. I just said the same thing without using the word subjective or experience. So what's happening is when my perceptual system goes wrong, I indicate that to you by saying subjective. And then in order to try and explain to you what my perceptual system is trying to tell me, I tell you about a hypothetical state of affairs in the world such that if the world were like that, my perceptual system would be telling me the truth. Okay. Now let's do the same with the chatbot. So suppose we have a multimodal chatbot. It has a robot arm that can point, and it has a camera, and it can talk, obviously. And we train it up, and then we put an object in front of it, and we say, point at the object. No problem, it points at the object. Then when it's not looking, we put a prism in front of the camera lens. And then we put an object in front of it, and say, point at the object, and it points over there. And we say, no, that's not where the object is. The object's actually straight in front of you, but I put a prism in front of your lens. And the chatbot says, oh, I see. The prism bent the light rays, so the object's actually there, but I had the subjective experience it was there. Now, if it says that, it's using the word subjective experience exactly like we use. And therefore, I say, multimodal chatbots can already have subjective experiences. If you mess up their perceptual system, they'll think the world's one way, and it'll actually be another way. And in order to tell you how they think the world is, they'll say, well, they had the subjective experience that the world was like this. Okay, so they already have subjective experience. Now, you become a lot less confident about the other things. Consciousness is obviously more complicated because people vary a lot on what they think it means, but it's got an element of a self-reflexive element to it, a self-awareness element, which makes it more complicated. But once you've established that they have subjective experience, I think you can give up on the idea there's something about them, something about us that they will never have. And that makes me feel a lot less safe.
So do you think there's a difference between consciousness and self-consciousness? You said consciousness has a self-reflexiveness to it, but right. Some consciousness does.
Yes. So philosophers have talked a lot about this. And at present, I don't want to get into that. I just want to get the thin end of the wedge in there and say they have subjective experience.
So for something to have subjective experience, does that not imply that it's conscious? Like, who is the subjective experience happening to? Where is the subjective experience being felt?
Okay. Exactly. So you say, where's the subjective experience being felt? That involves having a particular model of subjective experience that somehow, if you ask philosophers, when I say I've got the subjective experience of little pink elephants floating in front of me, they'll say, and you say, where are those little pink elephants? They say they're in your mind. And you say, well, what are they made of? And philosophers will tell you they're made of qualia. They're made of pink qualia, and elephant qualia, and floating qualia, and not that big qualia, and right way up qualia, all stuck together with qualia glue.
Uh-huh.
That's what many philosophers think. And that's because they made a linguistic mistake. They think the words experience of work like the words photograph of. If I say I've got a photograph of little pink elephants, you can very reasonably ask, well, where is the photograph? And what's the photograph made of? And people think that if I say I have an experience of little pink elephants, you can ask, well, where is the experience? Well, it's in my mind. And what's it made of? It's made of qualia. But that's just nonsense. That's because you thought the words experience of work the same way as photograph of. And they don't. Experience of, the way that works, or subjective experience of, is the subjective says I don't believe it. And the experience of is really an indicator that I'm going to tell you about my perceptual system by telling you about a hypothetical state of the world. That's how that language works. It's not referring to something in an inner theater.
When I hear the word perception, it sounds like an inner theater as well. Like if you say, I see something in my perceptual system, it sounds like there's this you that's seeing something on a perceptual system that's being fed to you. So that's the wrong model.
Yes. You don't see your percepts, you have your percepts. So photons come in, your brain does a whole bunch of processing. You presumably get some internal representation of what's out there in the world, but you don't see the internal representation. Let's call that internal representation a percept. You don't see that, you have that. Having that is seeing. But people are forever trying to think that you have the external world, something comes into the inner theater, and then you look at what's in the inner theater. It doesn't work like that.
There was a psychologist or neurologist who thought that the pons had to do with consciousness. And then recently, self-consciousness has to do with the default mode network. Okay, is there something, is there a part of an AI system that has to do with self-consciousness? And also, help me understand even my own terminology when I'm saying the AI system. Are we saying it's when it's running on the GPU? Are we saying it's the algorithm? Like, what is the AI system that is conscious or that has subjective experience? So where is it?
I guess that there's going to be some hardware that's running it, and it's going to be that system that's going to be conscious. That's if something's going to be conscious. Software by itself has to be running on something. I would have thought to be conscious.
What I'm asking is, just like prior, there was the pawns that was thought.
I think a good way to think about it is to think about what AI systems are going to be like when they're embodied. So, and we're going to get there quite soon because people are busy trying to build battle robots, which aren't going to be very nice things. But if a battle robot has figured out where you're going to be late at night, that you're going to be in some dark alley by yourself late at night, and it's decided to creep up behind you when you're least expecting it and shoot you in the back of the head, it's perfectly reasonable to talk about what the battle robot believes. And you talk about what the battle robot believes in the same way as you talk about what a person believes. The battle robot might think that if it makes a noise, you'll turn around and see it. And it might really think that in just the way people think it. It might have intentions. It might be intending to creep up behind you and shoot you. So I think what's going to happen is our reluctance to use words like believe and intend and think is going to disappear once these things are embodied. And already it's disappeared to quite a large extent. So if I'm having a conversation with the chatbot and it starts recommending to me things that don't make any sense, and then after a while I figure the chatbot must think I'm a teenage girl.
Uh-huh.
That's why it gives me all these things about makeup and clothes and certain pop groups, boy bands, whatever. And so I asked the chatbot, what demographic do you think I am? And it says, I think you're a teenage girl. When it says, I think you're a teenage girl, we really don't have any doubt that that's what it thinks, right? In normal language, you say, okay, it thought I was a teenage girl. And you wouldn't say, you don't really believe that, okay, it's a bunch of software or neural nets, and it acts as if it thinks I'm a teenage girl. You don't say that. It thinks you're a teenage girl. We already use thinks when we're dealing with these systems, even if they don't have hardware associated with them, or obvious hardware associated with them. We already use words like thinks and believes. So we're already attributing mental states to them. It's just we have a funny model of a mental state. So we can attribute mental states to them, but have a completely incorrect model of what it is to have a mental state. We think of this inner theater that's the mind and so on.
Just a moment. Don't go anywhere. Hey, I see you inching away. Don't be like The Economy. Instead, read The Economist. I thought all The Economist was something that CEOs read to stay up to date on world trends. And that's true, but that's not only true. What I found more than useful for myself, personally, is their coverage of math, physics, philosophy, and AI, especially how something is perceived by other countries and how it may impact markets. For instance, The Economist had an interview with some of the people behind DeepSeek the week DeepSeek was launched. No one else had that. Another example is The Economist has this fantastic article on the recent dark energy data, which surpasses even Scientific American's coverage, in my opinion. They also have the chart of everything. It's like the chart version of this channel. It's something which is a pleasure to scroll through and learn from. Links to all of these will be in the description, of course. Now, The Economist's commitment to rigorous journalism means that you get a clear picture of the world's most significant developments. I am personally interested in the more scientific ones, like this one on extending life via mitochondrial transplants, which creates actually a new field of medicine, something that would make Michael Levin proud. The Economist also covers culture, finance and economics, business, international affairs, Britain, Europe, the Middle East, Africa, China, Asia, the Americas, and of course, the USA. Whether it's the latest in scientific innovation or the shifting landscape of global politics, The Economist provides comprehensive coverage, and it goes far beyond just headlines. Look, if you're passionate about expanding your knowledge and gaining a new understanding, a deeper one, of the forces that shape our world, then I highly recommend subscribing to The Economist. I subscribe to them, and it's an investment into your intellectual growth. It's one that you won't regret. As a listener of this podcast, you'll get a special 20% off discount. Now you can enjoy The Economist and all it has to offer for less. Head over to their website, www.economist.com/toe, T-O-E, to get started. Thanks for tuning in, and now let's get back to the exploration of the mysteries of our universe. Again, that's economist.com/toe.